Hi friends, welcome back to VLSI Fab. Guys, we have been meeting after a long time. So now onwards, we will try to upload the videos regularly on VLSI Fab. So guys, the topic that I have taken today for the discussion has huge impact and when you go to the lower node technology. I will tell you in the later part of my video. And before starting the video, I would like to request the viewers to go through my previous videos, which are all from VLSI domain. And let's start the video without wasting time. It is important for the clock signal to ensure the proper functionality of sequential and combinational cells. Ensure that the width of the clock signal is wide enough for the cell internal operation. For that, minimum pulse width of the clock has to be maintained for proper output. Otherwise, the cell will go into metastable state and we will not get the correct output. In other words, clock pulse into the flop or latch or sink must be wide enough so that it does not interfere with the correct functionality of the cells. So, minimum pulse width violation checks are to ensure that the pulse width of the clock signal for the high and the low duration is more than the required value. So basically, this violation is based on what frequency of operation and technology we are working. Suppose if the frequency of design is 1 GHz, then the time period for each high and low pulse will be 500 PS, as like if we consider the duty cycle is 50%. So suppose a clock is propagating through huge number of stages, so it might happen that after reaching to the sink, duty cycle will be like around 30% or 40%. So it won't be around 50%, so it will be like 30 or 40%. So it might be happen that clock pulse is not wide enough to capture the proper functionality, so that time DCD will fail. So in the upcoming slides we will discuss why this min pulse width violations occurs and how we can improve it. So as we already discussed, suppose DCD at source is 50%, but due to long buffer chain or high tran nets intermediate to the sink, DCD at sink may be around sometime 30%, 20%, or sometime it may got vanish also. So that is also a probable case. So and sometimes because of high tran nets, signal may not reach to VDD or VSS, and this is called rail-to-rail failure. So normally we see that in most of the design, duty cycle always keep 50%. Otherwise, designer can face issues like clock distortion, and if in our design using half cycle paths means data launch at positive edge and capturing at negative edge. And again, min pulse width as rise level and fall level will not be same. And if lots of buffers and inverters will be in chain, then it is possible that pulse width can be completely vanish. Also, we have to consider the best and the worst case when clock get routed, and depend on that, decide that what should be the required value for min pulse width. Now, we know that rise delay and fall delay of combinational cells are not equal. So if clock entering in a buffer, then the output of the clock pulse width will be separate to input. So for example, if the buffer rise delay is more than the fall delay, then output of the clock pulse width for high level will be less than the input. So you can see in the slide, rise time, suppose it is a pulse of 1 ns, 1000 PS. Sorry, rise time is 30 PS, fall time is 40 PS. Okay, so as rise time is 30 PS, so the pulse will start from the 30, and as fall time is 40 PS, so 500 plus 40, it will go to 540 PS. So original pulse will be like start, it will start from 30 PS and it will, high pulse will end at 540 PS. So you can see the initially the high pulse was of 500 PS, but after incorporating rise time and fall time, the high pulse is of 540 minus 30, it's of 510 PS. So you can see delta is 10 PS, so I mean difference is 10 PS, and that is to in the single stage itself. So you can see in the single stage delta is 10 PS. So you can imagine if there are more stages, so that things we will discuss in the next slide. So you can see we have just calculated that for single stage delta is 10 PS. So what if there are multiple stages? Suppose we have considered 10 stages. So for 10 stage delta will be 10 into single stage delta, that is 10, that is 100 PS. So for high pulse it will be of 500 PS, that is initial pulse width, plus 100 PS, that is the delta. So total high pulse will be 600 PS, correct? So the new DCD will be how much? Initially the DCD is 50%, correct? That is 500 divided by 1000 into 100, but now DCD will be 600 divided by 1000 into 100, that is around 60%. So you can see the in the source DCD was 50%, and by the time it reached to the sink, it 10% got degraded. So 10% degradation due to the long buffer chain, or you can say there may be some hydrant nets also, or maybe some due to some crosstalks also, it may got deteriorated, and finally at the sink we get the DCD with 10% degradation. So we got some idea that DCD is mainly dependent on the rise and fall time of the cells. So if trend is bad, definitely DCD will get impacted, and because of the crosstalk also delay get added, and which may affect the DCD. And if the if there are more stages of buffers, it will add the delay in the single direction, which will deteriorate the DCD. So what you can do is you can swap those buffers to the pair of inverters, and deterioration will get will be less. So guys, if you want to know more on this topic, please comment it, and if you like this video, please like, share and subscribe VLSI Fab. So waiting for your response. Good night.